going to be talking today about a concept called Alzheimer's prevention, and even beyond that, we're going to be talking about what we can do to preserve the function and the health of our brain. You know, everybody in here has now heard of the Heart Smart Diet, the types of diets we should entertain to maintain bone mass, but really no one ever talks about what we can do to maintain the health of our brain. So it's obviously critically important information, and I think we're going to raise some eyebrows today, hopefully.
All the leaves are brown, and the sky is gray.
Chances of having Alzheimer's disease are 50-50 if you live to be age 85. It's a very healthy environment. I was very impressed getting off the plane at how healthy everybody looks. If you live to be age 85, your risk of Alzheimer's is a flip of a coin. We have in this country 4.8 million Alzheimer's patients diagnosed. That number is expected to double by the year 2030. It may include many of us. It's costing us $100 billion a year to care for these patients. And it is a preventable disease. That whole concept of preventing Alzheimer's disease is relatively new, but yet people don't want to talk about it. I remember when I was in medical school, we were in the neurology section, and we had a very well-known professor telling us about Alzheimer's, and he said, "What would you do, medical students, if you suddenly realized that you didn't have, your memory was failing, you really couldn't put your thoughts together?" And the student next to me raised his hand and said, "I would transfer to law school." And I will tell you that I plagiarized a lot of jokes. I wrote that joke. You can only listen to XM comedy so much and pick up for these talks. But I've been interested in this topic for a long time. I published my first paper in the Journal of Neurosurgery 30 years ago this week. Based upon work that I did when I was 19. And this was the work we were doing back then. I was dissecting the brain using the operating microscope when we had hair. And I'm going to tell a story that I've never told in a public forum before, but I think it's really interesting. I show up to the Shands Teaching Hospital in Gainesville, Florida, my first day. My project was to map the arteries in 50 human brains, so I walked in, ready to go. And I said, "Well, where are the brains?" And they sent me downstairs to what's called to the morgue, where the brains were. And I went down to the morgue, and I'm telling you this is a true story. And I walked in, and there was this large, kind of scary-looking man. And I said, "I'm here for some human brains. Where are they?" And he looked down at me, and he said, "The brains are inside the head." Now, that's not really a joke, because my task then, true story, was to go into the morgue with a craftsman tree saw, hand saw, identify these people, and the rest. Well, I'll leave that part out, you can only imagine. I get several heads. I put them in a plastic bag. I slung them over my shoulder in some macabre Santa Claus appearance, and in the basement of the hospital, I get in the elevator, put the bag heads down. I promise you this is a true story. And here I'm 19 years old. This lab technician walks by pushing a tray of rats. A young woman. And the tray got stuck in the grooves in the ground. So I jumped out, of course, to help her with the tray of rats. The elevator doors close. My bag of human heads goes upstairs into the regular hospital. I promise you that's a true story. Well, here are our possibilities. We can have a healthy, wonderful-looking brain, or we can have a brain that is atrophied, where the valleys between the mountains are enlarged and the mountains themselves begin to disappear. I think what you're going to find over the next period of 90 minutes is many things that I'm going to be telling you, you've heard this morning in Dr. Fornieri's talk, because the same fundamentals in brain health have to do with heart health, really have to do with physiology. You know, Western medicine has been one that has tried so hard to compartmentalize specialties and tease everything apart. Really, it reminds me of the blind man feeling the elephant. You know that story where one says it feels like a horse's tail, the other says it's hard like a tusk. But in reality, what we see is that the same fundamental concepts apply to brain health as they do to heart health. And this is called a holistic approach, looking at the whole. And, you know, I've been accused in years past of being practicing holistic medicine. That was almost a way to derogate me. But I have learned, since becoming interested in the larger picture of medicine, what the term holistic means. Basically, it means that my patients have a whole list of complaints and bring them in. That's what holistic medicine means. The fundamentals we've learned this morning are inflammation, damages the brain, and the downside of inflammation is increases something called oxidative stress. Now, oxidative stress means damage to tissues by chemicals called free radicals. We quench free radicals with antioxidants. That's the focus of my entire presentation. We've got to increase our brain protective antioxidant coverage to reduce the damaging effects of inflammation mediated by free radicals. That whole process is called oxidative stress. So it's getting to be mainstream. I mean, here's the cover of Time magazine talking about inflammation, the body being on fire. We're going to focus today on the brain being on fire, but as they talk about, this is the fundamental underpinning of such things as cancer and even Alzheimer's disease. Certainly coronary artery disease, as I'm sure Dr. Sinatra will talk about at lunchtime. But our issue is basically the brain in diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's is on fire. We don't feel inflammation in the brain, unlike the inflammation that you would feel in your knee, because the brain, oddly enough, doesn't have pain receptors, yet it's the center for pain perception. If your knee is inflamed, you feel that there's pain, there's swelling, there's production of inflammatory chemicals. The same chemicals are produced in the brain when it is on fire. Our task is to try to put that fire out or prevent the fire in the first place. We can actually image those cells that are involved in the whole inflammatory process. In the brain, we call them microglial cells. And I use these images because it shows dramatically when those cells are turned on that, in fact, the brain really does look like it's on fire. When we look at how the brain utilizes glucose, we see that actually those areas that have been compromised in the Alzheimer's patients are actually using much more glucose than normal tissue because they're becoming less efficient. If your car engine is in tune, you get poor gas mileage. That's what happens in the brain. You might think that, well, those tissues aren't working, so they're not going to be metabolizing very much. In actuality, they are hypermetabolic. And therein lies the problem. As those tissues are overactive, they produce more free radicals and damage the cells that are adjacent. Well, we know that inflammation is at the cornerstone of Alzheimer's disease because in the brain, we can actually measure the chemical mediators of inflammation called cytokines. You can measure cytokines if you put a needle in somebody's inflamed knee and take out the fluid. You can measure cytokines in the bloodstream of a person with coronary artery disease. Same thing happens in the brain. I just showed you that those white blood cells become turned on. They become what we call reactive microglia. There's something called the complement pathway. And this is a pathway that has to do with how inflammation is mediated in the body. And that's also turned on in the brains of patients with Alzheimer's. We know that people who have taken anti-inflammatory medications, that you're all familiar with, things like the non-steroidals, even things like